Thanks for checking out this movie review video. So this is for the 1982 film Turkey Shoot. And is this really horror? I mean, it kind of is, yes. But there are a lot of films kind of like this that just get thrown into that kind of horror-ish realm. And it's on Shudder when I'm doing this review, so just know you can check it out there. Now, this is a Brian Trenchard-Smith film. And if you don't know about Brian Trenchard-Smith, he's actually cited as being Quentin Tarantino's favorite all-time director. So if that doesn't get your interest or at least make you perk up a little bit to look into it, I don't know what to tell you. But he's done mainly a bunch of B-movie stuff. And I actually have his book that he put out not long ago that my wife graciously got me for my birthday called Adventures in the B-Movie Trade, which I hear is really well written. He goes into detail about a lot of the films he's done, so I'm sure there's something in there about Turkey Shoot. I will be reading that at some point, but it's apparently very funny as well. So I've just been very interested to get into it. Now, this was actually the second time I've watched Turkey Shoot. The first experience with the film, I think, is always the best because you really aren't ready for the level that it kind of like ratchets up with the violence and especially the kills, like the practical effects and how they pull the kills off. Because with the very first kill, you just get this idea, I'm just going to be totally disappointed in this film because this kill looks so stupid. And I think maybe the kill after that's kind of dumb too, but then they just start like moving it up and it has this grand finish. And that's why it's so much better to just see the first time. Still enjoyable on the second watching, but the first definitely better. So like I said, it's directed by Brian Trenchard-Smith. And he's done some other films such as Dead End Drive-In, which is in my stack of movies back here. I need to watch it. And we'll do a review on that. Night of the Demons 2, Leprechaun 3, and Leprechaun 4 in Space. That's just some that people will probably know him for. He's done a ton of films, though. Written by John George, who wrote scripts for The Final Terror and Don't Talk to Strangers, and Neill D. Hicks, who also worked on The Final Terror, Don't Talk to Strangers, but additionally, Dead Reckoning. Haven't seen any of those. The film actually bombed in the United States and Australia, which is where it was filmed, but apparently it did so well and actually set some records in the UK that it actually made up for a lot of the money that it lost in the US and in Australia, so okay. And that's the thing about a lot of these films, that it's so weird to see where they just bomb in one country and they go amazingly in another country. And it just goes to show how important kind of international distribution really can be, because if you can't make your money here, you can potentially make it there. But anyway, so the big name in this is Olivia Hussey, obviously best known by us horror nerds for her role in the original Black Christmas film, which is an amazing, amazing slasher film. I think it's considered the first slasher film, but is an amazing film. If you haven't seen the original Black Christmas, please. Although I'm sure majority of you watching this have. Just saying. So apparently she didn't have a great time with this film. Apparently she was very on edge the whole time, very anxious, very afraid, because filming in Australia, she was kind of afraid of the creatures in Australia and how there are a bunch of poisonous things there. And they were doing a lot of shooting, as you can see in the film, kind of out in nature, like jumping into rivers and going through the woods and going through this big cane field. So you're not necessarily going to see what's right there, you know, stepping on a poisonous snake or coming across a poisonous spider or, you know, things like that. So she was very on edge, apparently, for the entire film for that reason, and it was a terrible experience for her. Another one of the things is the nude scene for her in the shower, like the communal shower at the re-education camp. It was a body double, obviously, which usually you can really tell in films if it's a body double doing the nude scene, because they cut the head off, obviously. If they're showing the head and the body, it's obviously that person. If they're cutting the head off, it is most likely a body double. So she really didn't want to do the nude scene, so they got her a body double. Now, apparently, in some memoirs that she wrote later on in life, she actually lamented that she should have just done the nude scene, because she feels strongly that the body double they chose had not as attractive a body as her. So apparently she now looks back and says, man, I really wish I would have done that nude scene in Turkey Shoot, because my body looked a lot better than what people were thinking my body was watching that film. So just kind of an interesting thing. You don't really hear that all that often. The nude scenes, by the way, that kind of like communal shower scene where there are a bunch of nude people in the shower, that was actually filmed at a local hippie commune in Australia. And so, yeah, none of those people I don't think were actually in the film other than just that scene. Because of budget issues, the shooting schedule for this film was moved from 44 days to 30 days. Additionally, they ended up having to cut the first 15 pages of the script out, and they cut out a helicopter chase scene that was originally in the film. And I think that was about like $700,000 that ended up getting dropped almost right before they were about to start filming, because one of the investors apparently got cold feet, pulled out last minute. So they were like, we have a lot less of a budget. Got to cut some stuff. The opening montage of this actually gives you a really good idea about there being kind of authoritarian rule throughout the world, because they give you shots of all these different countries, kind of giving you the idea of either it's maybe individual authoritarian rule in all these places, or it's one global authoritarian rule, which would make sense for what the camp, the re-education camp, kind of feels like, and the fact that it's on an island that you might find out much later. But I think they did a good job by showing that kind of unrest in the streets, that, you know, the world is going to hell basically, and there's authoritarian rule, and that sets it up for you just falling into this premise of this re-education camp and just being like, okay, I understand, I get it. You know, they kind of go hand in hand. The re-education camp is for behavior modification to make people conform through force. It's something that you get up front pretty early, so you know that it's not going to be a very pleasant time. And I like how the guy at the camp can't stop cracking his whip when they first get there. The initial three people, Paul, Chris, and I forget the blonde's name. She lives pretty long, a lot longer than I actually assumed she was going to end up living. But she's the one who gets it in the end with all the stabs of the arrow from the female rich person who's on the turkey shoot. Which I wish they would have had that on camera, because they did a lot of other good stuff. So I don't know. But anyway, so the guy, when they first get there, who just keeps cracking the whip. It's just like, we have this bullwhip. We really want to use it as much as possible in this film. So he just keeps like cracking the whip. It got a little annoying, in my opinion. The guy's playing chess and drinking while talking about competition sets up the theme of the rich and powerful playing with the lives of other people. This is actually something that's really been, I don't want to say played to death, but played a lot in film, because I think it always works, really. The rich versus everyone else, basically. And this sets it up really well with that intro of the guys, you know, sipping on their, you know, bourbon or cognac or scotch or whatever they're sipping on while they're playing this large game of chess, and then talking about competition, and then checking the monitors with these prisoners and talking about the upcoming turkey shoot and who they're going to pick, basically, to go out and hunt. So it sets it up very well. They are clearly the villains, because nobody likes the rich, especially not when they act like that. And it's pretty timeless, actually, to have them as the villains, because there's always rich people and they're always doing bad things. They set up the idea that Paul is a formidable opponent to the establishment because he's escaped from a bunch of re-education camps before. That's kind of a bit of dialogue that gets said in the beginning when he's welcomed by Thatcher, the guy who runs the re-education camp. He kind of makes comment about how he's slipped his way out of other re-education camps. So it gives you this idea that he's supposed to be this badass, that if and when he gets out, that he's going to be a formidable opponent, and he'll have the opportunity to fight back, basically, which is what happens. So Ritter, the very large guard in this film, almost punching the woman, that's kind of like his big introduction to the film, like doing psychological terror to the woman, I guess is what he's doing, where she's standing there like trying to recite things and he's like almost punching her. I just think that's a really funny scene, until it gets to the point where he's just like slapping the crap out of her and picking her up and throwing her down, and then it just gets to be like, oh wow, this is, that escalated very fast. But it gives you the idea of how brutal, how terrible this camp is. Not sure they really needed to go there, but, you know, it was the 80s. They were doing that. The cage with the weight that you have to hold up is an interesting torture device that they show in this, and I think it goes to show, you know, kind of that next level as well of not only how brutal things are there, but also how inventive these people are. And because they're getting inventive at coming up with things like this, it shows a level of enjoyment in causing the pain and torment of these people there. That obviously it's not actually for re-educating people, you know, modifying their behavior. It's really for just being sadistic and doing terrible things to people, because that's what's getting these people off, basically. I like the character of Dodge in this, you know, the guy with the red hair and like his eyes are gigantic because of his glasses. He's pretty nuts as a character. You feel like you kind of never really know what he's going to do, because he's obviously unhinged with the way that he acts. I love the moment of them, you know, kind of gutting fish, and he just like eats some of the guts right out of the fish. I think that's a particularly funny moment, but I just love his character. They try to push Chris and Paul together romantically a little bit in the beginning, it seemed like, and that seemed really forced. So I'm actually glad that they didn't seem to really stick with that as much as the film progresses. It feels like they kind of backed away from it, but for a little bit there, it seemed like they were kind of trying to push them together, and it just didn't feel right. It didn't feel natural. It was dumb. So I'm glad it kind of didn't really go there in the end. During the gasoline ball game, they make sure to show the satisfaction on the faces of the rich people who are watching. The one where the guy who had escaped and then was brought back had those balls of gasoline and they eventually light them on fire. They make a very big point of the rich people, the people in power there, showing their satisfaction with what's going on. Just again, kind of showing the level of how sadistic they are and how much enjoyment they get out of these horrible things. What's with the Wolfman? It's a very left field thing. I think his name was Alf, is what he was called by the one turkey shoot hunter guy. Just like a hairy dude with fangs, like a man beast, basically. He reminded me of the Island of Dr. Moreau, basically. Like, I feel like he was just like plucked out of that piece of literature and thrown into this. But it's a very left field thing. It's weird. But that's part of the charm of this film. Like, there's some left-field weird stuff, but it's fun. The score is crazy 80s synth, and I really dig it. I love that type of score for this time period, and it goes there, and it goes beyond, in my opinion. But I like it. Alf ripping off Dodge's toe and eating it? Funny. I love that moment. I think that's one of the funniest scenes, in my opinion, where they were kind of like, oh, we're going to break his ankle, we're going to do this, we're going to do that. And then he just like tears his toe off and eats it. And I'm just like, of course Alf would do that. He's crazy. Chekhov's exploding arrow crossbow. We saw it, now we got to see it in action. Yes, that's one of the things. Like, there are a bunch of things in this film that they show it initially as like a tease. And then you're like, yes, this will come in later. It's the whole Chekhov's gun type thing, like the exploding arrow crossbow, the kind of like front end load, is that? No, it's not a front end load. The bulldozer thing that the other guy has, you know, these things are teased. Alf himself actually is like a creature, like he's basically teased, so he's got to get used as well. They set it up and then they deliver on it, basically. Dodge's death is awful. And once that happens, you think it's all going to be disappointing, but that makes the surprise of the other kills so much better. So part of me thinks that they intentionally made Dodge's death really stupid because they planned on gradually ramping things up with the other deaths until they get to the really awesome deaths at the very end. So I think they were going for that kind of surprise wow factor as things kept building, and I like that, especially for, like I said, my first viewing of the film. The spiked log trap is unexpected and a really cool moment, and that's the moment that you know Paul legitimately has a chance. Like I said, it was teased that he had gotten out before. Now, with the log trap thing, you see that he has survival skills and that he's very crafty and innovative, and he can rig things up like that. So he's obviously got more than a little bit of a chance, more of a chance than anyone else who was out there. Alf getting cut in half is funny, and the practical effects actually look good when they cut back and they show just like the bottom half of his body kind of drop down. Really cool, good gore to that one. Love that scene. That's where it starts to get good with the kills. I was just like, that's the first one that really surprised me. I was like, oh, okay. And then you got more and more, and I felt like they kept one-upping themselves. They definitely cover a lot of ground during Turkey Shoot as far as, like, actually adventuring across a lot of land and water. And I think that's cool. I like that aspect of it. It makes it seem more adventurous. It makes you feel like the film's really going places, legitimately covering a lot of ground, and it's fun. It's just supposed to be a big reveal when Chris and Paul find out they're on an island. That's a big, that's supposed to be a big moment. It doesn't really feel like a big moment, because I think that most people watching the film would just kind of assume that they're not going to make it anywhere really anyway. Like, with the very beginning intro, like, you get the idea, like I was saying, that it's authoritarian rule. So, like, even if they were to actually get away, how long could they be outside of one of these re-education camps? I mean, Paul himself has proven to be a very formidable opponent, yet he's been caught many, many times, because how else would he have broken out of all these other re-education camps? So how far are they actually going to get? So the island reveal is supposed to be this, like, oh no moment, but it's really not, because they set enough up for people to just assume that things aren't going to go well, even if they get away. The hand chop is wonderful, especially with the touch of the twitching finger holding the gun. That nice little touch is just that twitching finger while it's severed, and the fact that they show both the hands severed from the body. I really like that. Now, apparently when they were shooting that scene, Trenchard-Smith had actually yelled cut at one point, and Olivia Hussey apparently misconstrued what he meant, and she thought he meant cut as in, like, swing, and she actually almost cut the actor's hand off, the guy who plays Ritter, apparently. That's what I read. I don't know. That's what I've heard. So, wow. Because it was a real machete, and you can tell that if you're watching. The automated gun turrets that they have at the re-education camp, those things suck. They have horrible aim. They have the aim of the killbots in Chopping Mall. Literally. They shoot so many bullets, every single one of them miss, until the nameless characters come out, and then some of them get hit with it. But it's, the other thing is, like, they totally miss Paul and Chris when they're in that vehicle, every single shot, even though they're shooting a lot. And they're going slow. Like, that's the thing. Like, these turrets are the worst turrets ever, and I don't understand why they're there if they're that bad with aim. Because, like I said, Paul and Chris were moving very slowly. Maybe they weren't calibrated properly. I don't know. The exploding arrow stabbing with the head blowing up is pretty great. Love that scene. Obviously, when Chris gives that woman a taste of her own medicine and rams it into her face and boom, exploding head. That's another one of those great kills. Really enjoy that one. The chaos at the end is shot and directed pretty well, actually. Keeps you very engaged. And that's what I was talking about. It's like this big, grandiose finish that feels awesome and just gets you hyped up. It gets you excited. Like, the scale of this kind of fighting that's going on back and forth is, it feels grand and it works really well, I feel. And the best part of the film, when Thatcher's head gets blown up by the high caliber machine gun bullets that Paul is shooting. Wow. I mean, I did not see that coming, especially practical effects to that degree, even though there were some other good ones in it, but that was the pièce de résistance. Awesome. Awesome way to kind of end things with that film. Really love it. And they really went big. Like I said, they really went big in the end, and I think it makes the slowness in the beginning kind of all worth it at that point, because I feel like they spent a little bit too much time just kind of like hanging out at the re-education camp. Not a ton, you know, not too much, but a little bit too much. So, but overall, it was a good time. This film is basically a take on the 1924 short story, The Most Dangerous Game by Richard Connell, which actually has been used many times with other, you know, other pieces of literature, movies, you name it. Tons and tons of stuff. So it's just kind of their own take, the writer's own take on The Most Dangerous Game, which is just basically about hunting people. Yeah. Freedom is obedience. Obedience is work. Work is life. That's what I'm going to leave it with, because that is the quote of this re-education camp, which is said a few times, so it kind of like really gets ingrained in your head, which I assume is what they're doing with the prisoners there. So I just found that to be a good quote for a very dystopian situation. So anyway, out of 5 stars with half stars in play for this film, I'm going to give it 3.5 stars. I was between 3 and 3.5, but I'm bumping it up to 3.5 because of how it ratchets things up with the kills and the practical effects in the end, and then how it just has that grand finish. I really enjoy this film. I think it's very underrated. I think a lot of people don't even know about it. So do your part and tell your friends to watch Turkey Shoot, because it's been on Shudder for a while, and it's still on Shudder, at least when I'm putting this review up. So, yeah. But I would love to hear your opinions on Turkey Shoot. Go ahead and put it in the comments. Let's talk about it. And do me a quick favor, hit the subscribe button if you have not already. It really helps to motivate me to keep doing these reviews because, you know, sometimes it feels like, oh man, I'm doing another one. Because it does take a good amount of time. So if you could, you know, throw me a bone, hit that subscribe button. I really legitimately am motivated by that. When I get the email saying new subscriber and it shows me who it is, I look at it and I'm like, that's awesome. Thank you. Because it lets me know that, you know, people are actually enjoying what I'm doing. It's worth my time in that case. So also hit the notification bell button because then you'll know when I'm putting up new videos so you can see them sooner if you want to. But regardless, I really thank you for taking your time to check this out. And until next time, keep it brutal.